trials, and I've had doubts. I felt your presence and walked it out. Every step of my life, you've been here with me. As we walk together down a road I cannot see, I wanna live all you died for me to be. I wanna walk in all you both on the tree, 'cause you suffered so much pain. You didn't suffer that pain in vain, 'cause I won't live or die for me to be. Now this road isn't easy.
Good evening. We have a special event going on right after service, so we will not have double session this evening. Turn to Romans chapter 9. As is our custom, we do take a moment of silent prayer to give us the opportunity to enter into fellowship with God, which of course means naming and citing any known sins if we have any. And also if there's something that you might be concerned about, any cares and worries, cast them aside right now and give God your undivided attention as the Word of God is being communicated. With that in mind, let us pray. Thank you, Father, again for the privilege that we have to gather together as members of the royal family, as members of the church, and we consider it a privilege that you have given us your Son so that we could have eternal life and freedom. And Father, with all the chaos going on in the world today, we know that it's fantastic to have you in control of all things. So Father, as we enter into our study this evening, we do ask that God the Holy Spirit would challenge us with the information that we are noting. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Well, we're now looking at Romans 9, 6 and 9, 7. And we're about to get into some very theological doctrines coming up, and probably it will begin on Sunday when we get to verses 8 through 10. But let's review. Romans 9, 6 says, however, this rejection, the rejection on the part of the Jews concerning their spiritual heritage, not their racial heritage, but this rejection is not to imply as though the word of God has failed. For they are not all Israel who are descended from Israel, which means they are not all true Israel, because you have to be born again and saved who are descended from Israel. And verse 7 goes on, talks about the fact that if they're Jews, that doesn't make them any special either, unless they are, again, believers in the Lord. So he says, neither are they all children, because they are Abraham's descendants, but through Isaac your descendants will be named. Now last night I gave you the principle that we noted, that word children, and it's important because it doesn't mean that children in the sense of as we know it. Tekna, T-E-K-N-A, means believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, called the children of Abraham in the sense of inheritance. Not just because they are children, but the children of Abraham in the sense of they are going to inherit the blessings of Abraham. Now, what does that mean again when it says neither are they all children? That means children of the inheritance or children of the promises given to Abraham. Remember, God said that he was going to be a blessing to many, many nations. And he was going to have children, by the way, who would, again, go forward in his plan and be the recipients of that plan. So what does it mean? Well, first of all, it means this. It means that Abraham had 8 sons. I gave you their names last evening. He had 8 sons altogether. Now, the first one, who was called the firstborn and usually gets all the blessings from the father and they get a double portion, was Ishmael. Remember, he was born from Hagar, that Arab, the Arab woman, because both him and his wife Sarah did not wait on the timing of God. So again, Ishmael was the first one. The second one, of course, was Isaac. Now, I want to go into this a little bit more this evening before we go on. Remember, Abraham's son came from 3 different mothers. He was married to two wives, not at the same time, and he had that slave girl. So the sons came from 3 different mothers. Hagar, this is feeding back a little, just bear with me as I try to get this to work a little better. Again, the sons had 3 different mothers. They came from that. And we have the first one, Hagar, the Egyptian slave girl, by the way, representing going to the world for solutions rather than waiting on the timing of God. And then we have Sarah, the Sumero-Arcadian. She was a princess. She's the one that Abraham was married to at that time. And she became a Jew the same time that Abraham did. And then after Sarah died, he married Keturah, who was an Arab woman who Abraham spent the rest of his life with. And as I mentioned to you last evening, even in our own nation right now in the political realm, the issue is still the fact that we have Jews and Arabs at war, because that will take place until the Lord Jesus Christ comes back. So remember that Abraham had 8 sons. They came from 3 different mothers. However, I don't want you to get the wrong idea, because a lot of individuals with human viewpoint will say, well, you know what, Sarah and Ishmael was probably the best because Abraham and Sarah were mature believers. Now, just because Sarah was a believer and she made God's Hall of Fame in Hebrews chapter 11, and so did Abraham. It's not because of Sarah and Abraham that Isaac was given the inheritance. God chose Isaac to receive the inheritance and not the sons of Hagar, the Egyptian slave, or Keturah, the Arab woman. You see, a lot of individuals think that that's because Abraham and Sarah were Jews. No, it's because Abraham and Sarah brought forth the only one of the sons who believed in Jesus Christ, who is Isaac. So it's not because that Abraham loved Sarah more than others. It has nothing to do with it, absolutely nothing. Even if we assume that Hagar and Keturah were the best mothers, it still wouldn't prove anything. If we assume that Sarah was the best one and she was a mature believer, that's why the other two did not have sons who got the inheritance. No, it has nothing to do with it whatsoever. Because you see, motherhood has nothing to do with it. In fact, I gave you a passage last evening. Go to Ezekiel chapter 18 again. And by the way, when I say motherhood has nothing whatsoever to do with it, that doesn't in any way denounce motherhood, because that's the way human viewpoint is perpetuated in our world today. They think that the children simply turn out the way that they do because of the parents. And therefore, if they turn out good, they reward the parents. If they turn out bad, they say, well, they did not do a good job with their children. However, the Word of God says contrary. You see, the reason why that Isaac received the fantastic promises is because of the fact that he made a personal decision. The other seven did not. And motherhood, many mothers, as we have in this local assembly, have virtue. But you see, virtue or lack of virtue on the part of the mothers has nothing whatsoever to do with Isaac receiving the inheritance or with anyone receiving the inheritance. The mother could be a winner believer, and she could still bring up individuals who are losers in life. And so that's why it's important to know Genesis 25. You're in Ezekiel 18. But in Genesis 25, we read, now Abraham gave what? All that he had to Isaac. Why didn't he divide it into eight parts? Why didn't he give a little to Ishmael? No, he gave all that he had to Isaac. So let's make an application before we go on here and why we're here. No one's parents has anything to do with their failures in life. Now, that's contrary to what you hear in the schools, in the educational system, and it says, well, the children are the results of their environment. That is not true. The first two children that ever lived were Adam and the woman. They weren't the results of their environment because they both fell. So don't blame the parent, the father, or the mother for how the children turn out. They can influence the children, and they can actually put them in the right direction as well as the wrong direction. But ultimately, remember, God chose the parent. And therefore, God knows what the best father or the best mother or the best family we all need to grow up in to know him. So I just thought I'd head you off. I'd head you off at the pass in case you want to blame your mother or your father for your problems like a lot of individuals do. In fact, I cringed this afternoon. It was around 3 o'clock. I got done studying. I put on the movie. What's it all about? It's all about an individual who says that he turned out the way that he did because his father abused him. So naturally, I just shut the stupid thing off and went back to studying. I guess that's why God gave me TV. That's part of the learning the 10 problem-solving devices. And by the way, if you're like me and watching the news, you're learning the 10 problem-solving devices, or your head's going crazy. I mean, it's like we're in two different worlds on two different planets. One station says this is true. The other station says that is true. We have no idea because I told you the media is basically made up of socialists. It's basically made up of individuals who came from Ivy League colleges colleges and universities as well, who teach liberalism. And so what we're seeing is that thought pattern being promoted because, remember, this is the devil's world. So you see, there are many losers in life. I call them losers because they want to blame their parents, or they want to blame their mother or father. Now, they'll say such things like, you caused me to be an imbecile. It's all your fault. If only I had a better father or mother or family life. What they're really saying is this: if I only had a better God, That's what they're really saying, because he's the one that chose your environment. As we saw last evening, he chose your parents. And if they're divorced or not divorced, if they had a good marriage or bad marriage, it still doesn't matter, because you are a product of your own decisions. Now look at verse 14. The Lord says, now behold, he has a son who has observed all his father's sins. This is in context is dealing with men who failed and parents or a father who failed and a father who was successful. It says, now suppose, or he does, he has a son who has observed all his father's sins, which he committed. And observing does not do likewise. You see, you hear people say, you made me like this, I'm just like you. And he says, this is what the prophet is saying, through what the Lord is saying through the prophet. Suppose that this child has a child who sees all the sins that were done by the father and mother. The child sees them, but in this passage doesn't follow in the parents' footsteps. Some of the greatest people I've ever met and greatest believers have grown in families where even their parents were not believers. And says he doesn't commit or observe his father's sins. Look at verse 15. He doesn't eat at the mountain shrines, that's idolatry, or lift his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel, or defile his neighbor's wife, or oppress anyone, or retain a pledge, or commit robbery. But instead, this individual, this son, gives his bread to the hungry and covers the naked with clothing. In other words, he doesn't bully anyone. He actually is the type of person that does the opposite of what his parents have done. He keeps his hand from the poor. That means that he doesn't exploit the poor. He does not take interest or increase, but executes my ordinances and walks in my statutes. He will not die for his father's iniquity. He will not suffer because of his parents or because of his father or mother. That's the son or child. And therefore he, the son or child, will surely live. As for the father, the mother, the parent, because he practiced extortion, robbed his brother, and did what was not good among his people, behold, he will die for his iniquity. In other words, the parent will die for what the parent did, for the sins of oppressing the weak, robbing the brothers and sisters, doing what is dead wrong. So God says in verse 19, yet you say, why should the son not bear the punishment for the father's iniquity, the parent's iniquity, when the son has practiced justice and righteousness and has observed all my statutes and done them? The Lord says, he shall surely live. See, what the Lord is saying, do you need to ask, why does the child not share in the guilt or the failures of the parent? Isn't it plain, the Lord is saying here? It's because the child took his volition and his freedom, and he made proper decisions with no manipulation whatsoever. And I like verse 20. It says, the person who sins, and of course this is a lifestyle, will die. Even if they are believers, they'll die the sin unto death. The son will not bear punishment for the father's iniquity, and the child does not share the guilt of the parent. Now notice next, nor will the father or the parent bear or be blamed for the punishment for their child's iniquity, the son's iniquity. The righteousness of the righteous will be upon himself. The wickedness of the wicked will be upon himself. And by the way, what the prophet is actually quoting is part of the Torah, the law in the Old Testament. Well, I don't have it up here. I thought I did. It's not coming up. But I'll tell you what, go to Deuteronomy. Go back to Deuteronomy chapter 24. I don't know what this mock means right here. Maybe something real spiritual and deep that I haven't been able to interpret yet. I'll get to it. Maybe I'll teach on that on Sunday, take the offering and go home. We'll be up by 10 past 10. Deuteronomy 24:16. And this is a part of the law that God has established for a nation to have freedom. It's a part of the law that God has established for them to prosper. And it's a part of the Word of God that should set many of you free if you've ever had any guilt about the fact that you don't think you were a good enough father or mother, or you did not have a good family life for your children. That's exactly what they needed to have the opportunity to draw them to God. It's better off if individuals go through all kinds of suffering and adversity for 70 or 80 years and spend the eternal life forever and ever with the Father. Father, I mean with God the Father, and in heaven, rather than having a great life, but ending up being separated with God, from God. Verse 16, Deuteronomy 24, here's a part of God's laws. Fathers shall not be put to death for their sons, nor shall sons be put to death for their fathers. Everyone shall be put to death for his own sin, his own failure, his own decisions. So motherhood has nothing to do with Isaac actually being blessed, absolutely nothing. And motherhood has nothing to do with an individual receiving the inheritance. I'm not talking about being blessed because of association. Of course, that's true. I'm talking about receiving the inheritance and having that family line go down to Isaac and not the other seven. And by the way, we learned that from the Lord Jesus Christ. Motherhood is great. And a lot of people, unfortunately, will follow teachings that elevate our Lord's mother at a place where she should not be. And the Lord said something very interesting. He talked about motherhood. And many of you remember he was talking about Beelzebul. He was talking about Satan in the kingdom of darkness. And then a female, a woman in the midst of the crowd yelled out this in Luke 11, 27. It came about while he said these things. He was teaching doctrine. He was teaching about the kingdom of darkness. One of the women in the crowd raised her voice and said to him, "Blessed is the womb that bore you and the breasts at which you nursed." Wait, can you imagine someone getting up and instead of saying, "Blessed are you, O Lord," they said, "Your mother's blessed to have a child like you. Your mother's blessed. Blessed is the womb that bore you and the breasts at which you nursed." And the Lord knew exactly what was happening. He turned around, put the woman right in her place and said this, "On the contrary, blessed are those who hear the word of God and observe it." Which again is the important principle of the fact that your real family are those who are hearing God's word, those who are observing the word of God. So motherhood's a great thing. Don't get me wrong. There's nothing wrong with it. We're all for it. But so many things that are great still won't make you spiritual, and they still won't give you salvation. There's nothing wrong with a motherhood, but motherhood will pass someday, and you're going to be by yourself, and you will be responsible in Romans 14:10 to make your own decisions. And that's why when Genesis 25, 20, verse 5 says, Abraham gave all that he had to Isaac, it was not because Isaac was from Sarah or a favorite son of Abraham. It's because Isaac believed in the Lord Jesus Christ and made his own decisions to go forward where he made God's Hall of Fame as well. He believed in Christ, or in the Old Testament, Jehovah Elohim, while Ishmael rejected Christ. So the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the Lord Jesus Christ, is the only means or solution to being true Israel. The Jews are not special because they're Jewish. Israel is not special because of the nation. It's the true Jew and true Israel, and the reason why they're blessed is because of the God that is watching over them. So only the Jews who have believed in Christ are included. And we can see the problem immediately. In fact, Paul had this, and some of you can identify with this. The problem is a very, very serious one. It's a problem and burden for any Jew, like the Apostle Paul, who has believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. They carry one of the greatest of all possible burdens, you see, because the true Jew knows that many individuals whom he loves, his father, his mother, his brothers, his sisters, his wife, his children, whatever that relationship may be, he knows that the Jews are so close. Just like we have people in your life that are religious and they're so close. The Jew is so close because he has the heritage of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but he is so far. Unless he does what Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob did, and again, that's to believe in Jehovah Elohim, the God of Israel, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now go back to Romans chapter 9. So close, and yet so far. I think there was a song like that named after something similar to that. But think about it. It must be a perpetual source of sorrow of great tragedy for a person who's born again and saved, and they're a Jew, and they grow up, and all of a sudden they realize that their parents or their loved ones don't understand Psalm 22 about the Lord Jesus Christ in their own Torah. They don't understand that Isaiah 53 is talking about the Messiah, that the Messiah would suffer. They translate that as the nation suffering, and therefore they elevate the race rather than the Lord Jesus Christ. And many of you know individuals that you have to actually be very, very patient with. They're members of your family that you love, and you know that even though you want to believe it, you really don't have the proof that they're really born again and saved. They don't have the fruit, and they reject the Word of God. They reject what God's Word says. They may be good people, sweet people. They're so close, but so far away. And if you ever have that problem, you have to do the same thing that Paul did. Keep going forward in the plan of God, and let your life and the words from your lips reveal what truth is all about. So the difference between the Jew is this. The Jew is so close. He has that heritage right here, but the difference between the true Jew and the racial Jew, the physical seed of Abraham and the spiritual seed of Abraham, is that dividing line. There's a difference. What is that dividing line? That dividing line, that invisible line, actually divides the human race. There's only two types of individuals in the human race, just two. There's one who believes and one who does not. And that's why John 3:36 says this, "He who believes in the Son has eternal life, whether they're Jew or Gentile. He who does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him." And the wrath of God ultimately will be manifested by the absence of God. You see, a lot of people think the wrath of God is God pounding people or lighting fires under them or making them suffer or torture them. That's not the wrath of God. God's wrath is to be absent from these individuals because their free will did not want them there, did not want him there in time. And by the way, they're not going to desire him after they go to a place of separation. Their sin nature is going to get worse and worse and worse, scar tissue of their soul, hardness of the heart, and they will finally come to a point where they realize that they have the absence of love. Because God is love. The absence of justice, there will be no justice. The absence of righteousness. How about this one? The absence of truth. Think of how exciting it is for most of us that when we wake up every day, we can see the lie that's being perpetuated in our day and age. We know the media is lying to us. We know what we're being lied to through radio, the internet, written material. And yet we're free because we're saying, keep on, bring it on. Because what's happening is it's causing us to expect the Lord Jesus Christ, and the times are changing so much where he's ready to come back. So to have the absence of truth, the absence of power, the absence of blessings, the absence of eternal life, the absence of faithfulness, joy or happiness, prosperity, just to name a few. That's what the eternal lake of fire is all about, being separated from God. Verse 6 again. However, this rejection of the Jews concerning their spiritual heritage, not their national one, is not to imply as though the word of God has failed, because there are still Jews God will reveal and God will give the promises to. For they are not all Israel, true Israel, who are descended from Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they children, but in Isaac shall their seed be called. That is, they which are the children of flesh, these are not the children of God. Those who are Jews, those who live in the nation of Israel, who are still there, they are in the flesh. And it says, those who are in the flesh, are the children of the flesh, those are not the children of God. But the children of promise are counted for the seed. It's the children of promise. They have to have that seed. What is it? That same incorruptible seed that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had, which is the nature of God. For this is the word of promise. And look what it says. At this time I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. All the other sons were not a part of the word of the promise. This was. Why? Was it because God violated the free will of Isaac? Not at all. We'll begin a study on that coming up about the fact that God doesn't violate any of our free wills. And you say, well, how can he say that Isaac is going to be a believer? Because God is the one who deposits life or a soul into that fetus, into that particular individual, and that soul has already revealed to God that it would be positive toward God. So he puts the positive soul in a certain body, and he does so, and that person comes up and makes their own decisions with their own free will. So God knew billions and billions of years ago what Isaac would choose, just like God knew billions and billions of years ago what you would choose, which is why Ephesians 1:4 says that we're in Christ. You were chosen in Christ before the world was ever created. And the world's been around for more than 6,000 years, by the way. You were chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. Why? Because God said, I'm going to elect some and not others? No, because he saw the decisions that you would make when you are put in the proper environment, as we saw with marriage on Wednesday and Thursday. So you are left on this earth for one principle right now. Why is it that when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, we're not taken right to heaven? Well, first of all, that would not be a real good evangelistic principle. You know, the minute someone says, I believe in Christ, they die. So what happens is that God wants you to have the opportunity to exercise your free will. And you and I are left on this earth to make thousands of decisions. And in your lifetime, you'll make decision after decision. The most important decision you will ever make, of course, the most important one, is what the thief on the cross did. He believed in the Lord Jesus Christ because he knew that the Lord was the Messiah. He saw the Lord's life in action as he was being persecuted. Even on the cross, when he was going through the most difficult time of his life, after he had just been separated from God, he was still reaching out to people trying to reveal the grace and mercy of God. So the most important decision, of course, you make is to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But after that, now you have the opportunity to have a fantastic life in time. You have to face the principle of being challenged by Satan in the kingdom of darkness and his deception time after time. We see it everywhere. It doesn't matter where we go. The challenge is a very simple one. There's one thing in life that is totally and completely important, more important than anything else. Everything else is secondary. And it depends upon your own concepts, your own background, your own scale of values, what decision you will make. And of course, the one thing I'm talking about is learning the Word of God. You are here after you've made the greatest decision in your life to make the second greatest decision. Now, I did not say what I'm about to say, so I want you to go to Luke 14. You can mock me, you can disagree with me, you can criticize me and say, who does he think he is? You're not criticizing me, by the way. I did not say this. You know, people don't like this. They think I put down the family, I put down marriage, I put down husbands or wives. I don't do that. I'm simply repeating what my Lord and Savior has given me a command and a mandate to tell you. And I care more about what he thinks about me than I do about what you think. And you should be the same way. So I did not say this. I'm not the one who said in Luke 14:26, where our Lord makes this statement, and this is the second greatest decision you can ever make. And isn't it great? It always comes around on the holiday season, Thanksgiving and Christmas. You know, you got to be with the family and all of that. That's fine. Look what it says in verse 26. If anyone comes to me and does not meseo, not hate, but love less his own father, back to the parents again, and mother, and wife, and by the way, I dedicate this to all the soccer moms because they can't come to Bible class because little Johnny's little game is more important. Buy little Johnny a soccer field in your backyard, start your own league, and then do it on the time that God has given you, not on God's time. But I'm investing in my children. No, the greatest thing you can do to invest in your children is what you're doing right now. So, if anyone comes to me and does not love his father and mother, his wife, his children, and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Please notice that the husband's not mentioned here because you should love your husband more than you love God. No. I'm only saying that. It's not there. I just saw it. I told you. I look at every word now in the passage. I go, where's the, how come it mentions the, you know, the wife but not the husband? If anyone comes to me and does not love less his own father and mother, well, he's probably talking to his disciples, and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life. He can be saved, but he's not going to receive the inheritance. He's not going to be a winner believer. He's not going to receive all those blessings that were designed for him from eternity past. And that's why it doesn't say he cannot be saved. It says he cannot be what? My mathetes, my student, the one who represents me on earth, because by this, by impersonal, unconditional love, all men will know that you are students of mine, disciples. All men will know that you're living a supernatural way of life by your fruit. So it does not say you cannot be saved. It just says you cannot be my disciple. And then he goes on to say this. This is the second greatest decision we could ever make. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me. Notice we all have a cross to bear. And come, when we bear that cross, we don't freak out, fall apart, complain, murmur, or criticize, and wonder why God has brought this plan, that God has brought this situation in our lives. I'll answer that on Sunday morning. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Now, why did the Lord say this? Because he's on an ego trip? Because he wants you to make, he wants to make sure that you know he's number one. He said this, and it doesn't sound good, but it doesn't sound like it's going to be something of a blessing, but he said this because of what he says in Luke 18. Go forward to verse 29. He said this for our own blessing, if we have faith to believe him, or would you rather believe Wall Street? I love Wall Street falling apart. Because I got no stocks anymore anyway. But you know what? I love to see the problems when people are going to wake up and realize that it's not about what they have accomplished. And he says this, truly I say to you, Luke 18, 29, there is no one who has left house, and that means you have left the ability to get something better or someplace better to live, but it was going to take you away from God, so you refused to do so. I say to you, there's no one who has left house or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who shall not receive many times as much. By the way, at this time in your life, you're going to receive better house, better wife, better brother, better parent, better children, especially if both of you have positive volition toward doctrine and you're married. It says you're going to have more children. You're going to have more friends, more blessings. You're going to have more prosperity. You shall receive, by the way, you shall receive many times as much in this time and in the age to come. Prosperity in time, prosperity in the eternal state, contrary to the world's way of doing things. See, God's viewpoint and God's thoughts are not our thoughts. So God says, follow me first and then you'll be blessed. The world says, make sure you go first after the things of the world, and after that you can settle down and relax and then you'll have time to serve God. That is opposite. So I didn't say this, the Lord did. And by the way, the Lord did, and that's your Lord, by the way, too. So stop blaming the messenger for the message, because you see, he has been mandated to proclaim to you these truths. Bible doctrine and the Word of God must be so far ahead of you in any every realm, in the sense that you have to always put other things aside. It must be so far ahead in your commitment, your standards, your values, your scale of values, so that nothing will ever distract you from going forward from the intake of God's Word. It is the intake of the Word of God where we get the fantastic blessings in life and makes life worthwhile. You see, life has its savor. Life has its blessings. Life has meaning and purpose. And there's no difficulty in life, no problem, no adversity that is too great for Bible doctrine, the Word of God. You have the answer to all of your problems right there. But the believer without doctrine, well, you know them. And I'm not talking about the unbeliever. They need salvation. The believer without doctrine is a hopeless wreck. He's a mess, frustrated, complaining, murmuring, behind the eight ball, etc. Always in trouble, having difficulty. Avoid, they always blame people, like the son blaming the parents and vice versa. Never being able to handle situations in life. Why? Because they had their priorities wrong and they got involved with the devil's game in the cosmic system. And that happens no matter who the person is. They can have a great environment like Isaac did, or they can have an environment where there's no parent there. They could be brought up as an orphan. God knows that that's the environment that they need to go forward in his plan. You see, there are many things that people want in life that they search for, and they think that they're going to get it according to the natural way of receiving it. Listen to my program. Watch this paid commercial. I'll show you how to have positive thinking. I'll show you how to attain things. You can sit at home and do nothing and make $20,000 a month. Just write in for my book at $19.95 because that's how much I'm making on you fools who believe that. You see? And you're going to be miserable and frustrated and upset, as some are right now. And do you know that being miserable and frustrated and upset is a blessing? Because you have to look in the mirror and say, I'm getting sick of this. Well, God has a plan. God has a destiny. God has blessings just for you. Doctrine is close, so close, and yet so far away. There's going to be distractions. I'm sure that many of you will be distracted as members with members of the opposite sex. You're going to be distracted by going forward with a new job, more money, etc. And you're going to think that those things can give you happiness. And when you go after those things and there's nothing wrong with them, don't neglect the Word of God, then everything becomes wrong. When you go after those things according to God's Word, trust me, you're also going to have problems and difficulties. And you're going to lose out on certain things in life, but you'd rather lose out on things in life right now so that you can have them for all of eternity. So the unfortunate thing today is we have a lot of people who think they know everything. They think they're very intelligent. Just look around. Look at the fruit. What are we seeing? We're seeing the fruit of a stupid people. We're seeing imbeciles. We're seeing people that believe the lie. It's almost like you want to go to work or see members of your family, grab them by the throat and say, can't you see what's going on? And they think that they're smarter than you. You see, people, while being smart, so they think, are being totally, completely, and stupidly deceived. They are under deception. There's absolutely no happiness in that. There's no happiness. So many people care about the approbation of people. I want people to think well of me. Well, score a couple of touchdowns in the football game on Sunday, and they'll be cheering you right on. Miss that final catch the following Sunday where your team would have won, and you'll be the worst heel in the world. Fickle people. One day they love you. One day they can't stand you. Why? Human viewpoint thinking. So in Romans 9:9, let's go back to that before we close. Don't do what we're going to see happen with the twins and what happened in Romans chapter 9, because a lot of individuals are going to be led astray. They're going to be stimulated by the wrong things in life. And by the way, we're going to see Esau coming up. Many will actually lose out just as Esau lost out. He sold his birthright for a pot of baked beans. Do you ever wonder why it was a pot of baked beans? Because God wants to show you how little and minute the things of the world are that people chase after when they could have fantastic blessings. So he actually sold that baked beans because he was hungry, or a mess of pottage. And by the way, it wasn't a mess. It was really something that was very good. So Romans 9:9, notice what it says. For this is the word of promise. At that time will I come, Sarah shall have a son. And by the way, that's Isaac. And not only this, but when Sarah marries Rebekah, when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac. And of course, here comes Jacob and Esau. For though the twins, Jacob and Esau, were not yet born, notice, and had not done anything good or bad. They were not yet born, had not done anything good or bad, in order that God's promises, according to his choice, his election, might stand, not because of works, but because of him who calls. Now, that seems to be contrary to the fact that we have a free will. No, God just wants us to know that he knew everything about these individuals, just like he knows everything about you, and he knew it billions and billions of years ago. And being a perfect God, a God of love, a God of justice, a God of omniscience, all knowledge with all power, he decided to make sure that he has a plan for your life so that you could be a winner, so that you could enjoy blessings in this life and blessings for the eternal state. So there's no violation of someone's free will like the Calvinists teach. And it was said to her, notice this was said to Rebekah, the older, here we go again, the firstborn, Esau, because he came out first, the older will serve the younger. Just as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. And of course, that's an anthropopathism that does not mean God hates. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were all elected or chosen by God because of the omniscience of God, not because God violated their free will. God in his omniscience, all knowledge, God knew billions of years before they were born that Isaac would believe in the Lord and would advance to spiritual maturity. And he knew about Jacob and Esau as well. And the same thing is true, as I mentioned, of many of you. If you actually really believe this, it will be revealed by your priorities. If you actually believe what I'm about to say, you won't have a problem with making positive decisions at all, because you'll recognize why you are here, the reason why you are here, the reason why you are still alive. You have been elected, not because of an arbitrary decision on the part of God. Election doesn't mean just to be saved. It means to give you the highest and best, to give you the opportunity to have fantastic blessings in time and in the eternal state. God, the omniscience of God knew billions and billions of years ago what you would choose, the free will decisions that you would make. And being alive is a blessing. I don't care if you're not healthy. I don't care if you're healthy or not healthy. Being alive is a blessing. I don't care if it's a good marriage or a bad marriage. It's a blessing because it's God giving you the opportunity to enjoy blessings now and blessings forever and ever. And he knew, for many of you, that you would follow doctrine. He knew that many of you would advance to the point of maturity. And so the omniscience of God simply anticipates the function of our free will. That's why he says, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. He's just saying that Esau is not going to be a believer, Jacob is, and he's going to be blessed by God. So free will to believe in Christ, God knew. Free will to choose for doctrine, he knew. A free will to abide in the Master's hand. Now, I want you to listen to this. I've said it before, and I've given you this many, many times. Not many times, I think twice already. It's called The Touch of the Master's Hand. It was battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought it hardly worth his while to waste his time on the old violin, but he held it up with a smile. What am I bid, good people, he cried. Who starts the bidding for me? $1, $1 do I hear two. $2, who makes it three? $3 once, $3 twice, going for three. But no, from the back of a room, a gray-bearded man came forward and picked up the bow. Then wiping the dust from the old violin and tightening up the strings, he played a melody pure and sweet as an angel sings. The music ceased, and the auctioneer with a voice that was quiet and low said, what now am I bid for this old violin, as he held it aloft with its bow? $1,000, $1,000 do I hear two, $2,000 who makes it three, $3,000 once, $3,000 twice, going and gone, said he. The audience cheered, but some of them cried, we just don't understand. What changed its worth? Swiftly came the reply, the touch of the master's hand. And many a man with his life out of tune, battered down with guilt and sin, is auctioned cheap to a thoughtless crowd, much like this old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He's going once, he's going twice, he's going and almost gone. But the master comes, and the foolish crowd never can quite understand the worth of a soul and the change that is wrought by the touch of the master's hand. Isn't that great? All he wants to do is touch you, but we have all these things stopping him from doing so when we have negative volition toward the word of God. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, again for the privilege that you've given us to gather together and to study your word. Thank you that we understand that you have a plan for all of us, and that all we have to do is be available to you, knowing that you have seen that our free will would respond in certain types of situations, needing certain types of adversities and problems and difficulties. We now know more than ever before that you are in charge and that these things are for our sake. And so, Father, when we look at adversity and problems and difficulties and bad relationships and problems with wealth and problems with health, problems in the realm of having with the children and the family, we just know that there is always a solution through the Word of God. So we ask that you remind us of these things on a consistent basis so that we may go forward in your plan and understand that we all are in the Master's hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.